Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you all for coming this morning and joining together in the worship of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome to any visitors who might be here this morning. We are Lutheran Memorial Church, a sister congregation of the Church of the Lutheran Confession. For our service this morning, we'll be following the order of service as printed in our bulletin. We begin with prayer. O Lord God, we come together to hear your holy word, that through the hearing of your word we may be brought to repent of our sins, believe in Jesus in life and in death, and to grow day by day in grace and holiness. Hear us for Jesus' sake. Amen. We begin our Savior's worship service today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Continue with our opening hymn. Created us to love and serve him as his dear children, but we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy.
Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from conception. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be hither, I pray. Have mercy on me, according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin, and take away my guilt.
God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven you all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will.
Amen.
Withstand the temptations of your enemy, our enemy, the devil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow you, the only God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our first scripture reading for this morning comes from Psalm 7. We read the entire psalm. On this psalm, it's apparent that David had been accused, falsely accused, by who he calls Cush the Benjamite. Now, we're not exactly sure who Cush the Benjamite is. We're not exactly sure what his accusation was. We do see that David was in a great deal of stress over this accusation. Now, we have reason to believe that this happened while Saul was hunting down David, when Saul was still king, and that David went to the Lord in prayer regarding these false accusations. Now, as Christians, throughout history, we've also been accused falsely by many people, and especially today, I think we still see even more often reviling accusations that are false against us and against our Savior Jesus Christ. So, with David, we can also pray the same psalm, trusting in the Lord for deliverance. So we read Psalm 7. A meditation of David, which he sang to the Lord concerning the words of Cush, a Benjamite. O Lord my God, in you I put my trust. Save me from all those who persecute me, and deliver me, lest they tear me like a lion, rending me in pieces, while there is none to deliver. O Lord my God, if I have done this, if there is iniquity in my hands, if I have repaid evil to him who was at peace with me, or if I have plundered my enemy without cause, let the enemy pursue me and overtake me. Yes, let him trample my life to the earth and lay my honor in the dust. Selah. Arise, O Lord, in your anger. Lift yourself up because of the rage of my enemies. Rise up for me to the judgment you have commanded. So the congregation of the peoples shall surround you. For their sakes, therefore, return on high. The Lord shall judge the peoples. Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness and according to my integrity within me. O let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just. For the righteous God tests the hearts and minds. My defense is of God, who saves the upright in heart. God is a just judge, and God is angry with the wicked every day. If he does not turn back, he will sharpen his sword. He bends his bow and makes it ready. He also prepares for himself instruments of death. He makes his arrows into fiery shafts. Behold, the wicked brings forth iniquity. Yes, he conceives trouble and brings forth falsehood. He made a pit and dug it out, and has fallen into the dish which he made. His trouble shall return upon his own head, and his violent dealing shall come down upon his own crown. I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness, and will sing praise to the name of the Lord Most High. Our second scripture reading for this morning comes from Romans chapter 3. In this chapter, Paul is reminding the Romans, and he's reminding us as well, that our salvation doesn't depend on who we are. So he's telling the Romans, you don't have to be a child of Abraham. Rather, he reminds them that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory, even the Jews. But then he goes on to say, but it doesn't matter who we are, because Christ has paid for our sins. It's in Christ that we have righteousness through faith in his name. So we read Romans chapter 3. What advantage then has the Jew? Or what is the profit of circumcision? Much in every way, chiefly because to them were committed the oracles of God. For what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? Certainly not. Indeed, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written, that you may be justified in your words and may overcome when you are judged. But if our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unjust who inflicts wrath? I speak as a man. Certainly not. For then how will God judge the world? For if the truth of God has increased through my lie to his glory, why am I also still judged as a sinner? And why not say, let us do evil that good may come, as we are slanderously reported and as some affirm that we say? Their condemnation is just. What then? Are we better than they? Not at all. For we have previously charged both Jews and Greeks that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. Their throat is an open tomb. With their tongues they have practiced deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God, apart from the law, is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ, to all and on all who believe. For there is no difference. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness. Because in his forbearance, God had passed over the sins that were previously committed to demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? No, but by the law of faith. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith apart from the deeds of the law. Or is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also the God of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. Since there is one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. Do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. Here ends our scripture reading. Will the Sunday school teachers please step forward at this time for installation? Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, as well as our Luther Memorial Sunday School teachers for this year, as members of Luther Memorial, you have volunteered to respond to Christ's great commission to go and share his good news this year in our Sunday School. This is not only a high calling and responsibility, but also one that is carried out in a public way, not just as a representative of our congregation, but more importantly, of our Savior. Therefore, I ask you in the presence of God and of our congregation, will you promise to serve faithfully in all the tasks and responsibilities of this service according to the ability that God has given you? Will you strive to carry out the work that your Savior with joy and humility, seeking the Lord's guidance and help? And will you promise with the help of the Holy Spirit to practice what you proclaim in being a zealous ambassador for Christ and his glorious kingdom and leading these little lambs to their Savior? If so, then answer by saying, yes, I promise with the help of God.
Yes, I promise with the help of God.
Will you, brothers and sisters in Christ, members of Luther Memorial Church, gladly receive our fellow members as your Sunday school teachers? Will you support and encourage them as you have opportunity to do so? And most importantly, will you keep them in your prayers as they work on the behalf of our Lord and our congregation through this year? If so, then promise, we will.
We will.
In view of our promises made for the work of our Savior's kingdom, please give to me your right hand. Go then and faithfully perform your work according to the lambs of Christ, the children of his church committed to your care. Assist the parents in bringing up their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, everlasting fountain of wisdom, we bless and magnify your holy name and give thanks to you for your abundant blessings. We pray that your word may run richly through us and through the children you bring to our Sunday school in the coming year. Let your name be continually glorified among us. Give to your servants your Holy Spirit and supply them with the wisdom to lead our little ones to you. Let the children profit from their instruction in your holy word, that they may be rooted and growing in their faith all the days of their life. Continue to build your kingdom both here and abroad until you come again to bring us all to be with you in our heavenly home. Hear us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in the peace and blessing of our Lord Jesus and serve him with gladness. We continue by confessing our faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please rise for the confession. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the next hymn, hymn 798 of your Tan Worship Supplement. Christ promises that where two or three are gathered together in his name, he tells us, I am there in the midst of you. So as we all gather together this morning around God's holy word, we can trust that he is truly here with us, blessing our fellowship together. So this morning we join together in considering God's word according to Romans chapter 3, selected verses 21 through 26 that we already read in our scripture reading. That's the underlined section. Dear friends in Christ, dream big, never give up. Laughter is the best medicine. Always just be yourself. Words to live by. We're all familiar with such words to live by, the type of things that you might tell children as they're growing up. They say that if you live by doing these things, you're going to have a great life. Now, do you agree with that? Well, these words are fine, but there's actually much better words to live by. Today, Paul presents us with some of these words, words that I call churchy words to live by. Now, by churchy, I mean those type of words that we find in Scripture, type of words that when people hear them, they might get scared away because they don't understand them. The type of words that when we read Scripture, when we hear these words, we might not understand what they really mean. And Romans is full of such words, words that may seem confusing, but words that point us directly to our Savior. So, because oftentimes we forget what these words mean, I think it's important for us to consider these words, to be refreshed on what they mean for us. So those words which we're considering today are righteousness, justified, and propitiation. Words that may seem hard to understand, but words by which we do live. Words by which we are given true life. So if you look at the back of your bulletin, at the very bottom of your bulletin, I'd like you to pull that out if you're able. You'll see a list of churchy words that I compiled. And along next to the churchy words are my mnemonic devices that I personally use when I try to remember what these words mean. So if you look at the second line there, you see our first word that we're going to be considering, which is righteousness. So when I think righteousness, I think right with God. That's really what righteousness means. So you may have heard someone say in the past, I need to get right with God. This is something that someone might say when they want to reform their life, or maybe what they say when they're dying and they feel like they need to get right with God before they die just in case. And we know that we can't just get right with God. Becoming right with God, becoming righteous, doesn't depend on what we do, but rather it depends entirely on what God does, because righteousness belongs to God alone. And that's an important concept to understand because that's the central idea of the first verses of our text. We read verses 21 and 22. But now the righteousness of God, apart from the law, is being revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, through faith in Jesus Christ, to all and on all who believe. So we're told that God has revealed this righteousness to us, that he's made it easy for us to see this righteousness. Now, the Greek word used here for revealed, the form of that word is what we call the perfect tense. Now, in Greek, the perfect tense refers to an action that has been completed at some point in history, but the results of that event continue on throughout the rest of time. So we can't really point to many actions and say that action's results have continued forever. There's really, I had a hard time thinking of anything that we could describe in that way. Outside of God's revelation of his righteousness, the revelation of his grace, which he gave to us in his son, Jesus Christ. Because in that completed act of Christ dying on the cross, that is one action that has results that abide forever, even to now, 2,000 years after Jesus died, even 1,000 years in the future past this point. And sometimes it's hard for us to really believe that action that Christ did by dying on the cross for our sins It's hard to believe that that's still having an effect on us today. But we're told that that action, its results continue. Not only did he pay for the mountain of sins that had built up to that point in history, but he paid for the mountain of sins that would build up at any point in the future of history. So this is truly the completed action with results that have continued. And one aspect of this righteousness that we're considering that jumps right off the page for us is who this righteousness belongs to. If you look at our text, you notice it doesn't say anywhere that the righteousness belongs to us, but rather it tells us the righteousness belongs to God alone. Now, just as a brief exercise to prove this, I'd like every one of you, if you're able, to go up and go outside and go home and grab your righteousness, wherever you keep it. Just go and grab your proof of your righteousness that you own and bring it back here. No, we can't do that because none of us own righteousness. The only thing that we could do is we could go and grab our Bibles and open those up and point and say, no, it's God's righteousness, and he's given it to us. That is the proof of our righteousness. Now, because we recognize that this righteousness doesn't belong to us, but only to God, we also see that because we own this righteousness, that it was a gift from God. Now, if you put presents under the tree at Christmas time, and if you have small children, oftentimes they'll stand there and they'll marvel at the presents that are under there, and sometimes you might have a little one who sees the giant present hidden behind the tree, and when he sees it, he wonders, hoping that that present is for him. But without going up to it, he's just going to wonder, thinking maybe it's for me, but maybe it's for someone else. Maybe it's not for me at all. But then the child is able to go up to the present when his parents aren't around, and he's able to look at the tag. And if he opens the tag and sees his name written on the present, then he knows, without beyond a shadow of a doubt, that that present is for him. So when we're talking about the gift of God's righteousness given to us, sometimes we doubt whether or not that gift has been given to us or whether it was just given to other people. But God labels this gift as well. He says in verse 21, he says, "But now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed to all and on all who believes." So God tells us who's getting this gift. He's telling you that you, in whom he's planted faith in Christ as your Savior, you are the receivers of this gift. And you can be certain of what this means for you, that he has given you eternal life in his name. It's a gift of God, and he's given it to you. Now, when we connect these two verses, 21 and 22, with the previous verses, 19 and 20, God is speaking what one commentator calls a great nevertheless. See, in verses 19 and 20, we're painted a portrait of our sin and what that should mean for us. This is from our scripture reading. "The whole world may be held accountable to God, for by works of the law no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin." So, again, by ourselves, we cannot hope to be declared right with God. By ourselves, by our own merit, we're only seen as wrong, undeserving and unfit of God's mercy. And here's where the nevertheless comes in, because God says, you are sinful, nevertheless, you are righteous. You are right with God because of Christ Jesus, your Savior. We continue in our text, picking up to verse 23. "For there is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." So again, looking at the back of the bulletin, you'll find the word justify. And when I think justify, my mnemonic device that I like to think of it as just as if I never sinned. And when we look at ourselves, it doesn't take more than a second to realize, no, I have actually sinned. In fact, we sin regularly. And verse 23 reminds us of that, telling us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when I hear that phrase, all have fallen short of the glory of God, I usually picture God in his divine majesty, his radiance, his perfect glory up in heaven, and how, because of my sin, I'm unable to achieve that glory that God has. But really, the Holy Spirit, that's not the point he's trying to make here. He's not trying to say that because we sin, we haven't been able to achieve equal glory. But rather, the Greek word used here, doxa, is also translated praise. And that's really a better fitting word if we understand it as in praise that we accept from someone when we do something good. Or praise as in when someone has a good opinion of you and praises you. So we can really understand this verse as saying, all have sinned and fallen short of God's good opinion. Or all have sinned and are unworthy of God's praise. It was only 9 months ago that I asked Jess's dad if I could marry his daughter. And in that moment, it was extremely important to me that he'd have a good opinion of me. Many of you have probably been in similar situation with your fathers-in-law. Many of us have also been to job interviews during which we're hoping that the interviewer will form a good opinion of us and hire us. We spend so much of our lives focusing on what others think about us. We spend so much time thinking about it and hoping that people will have good opinions of us. And yet, the most important one in all of our lives, not our father-in-law, but rather our Heavenly Father, we're told he did not have a good opinion of us. He decided that we were not worthy of praise because we had all sinned and we all continue to sin. And there's no difference who you are. The statement remains true. Even though the Jews were children of God, God's chosen people, it doesn't matter if you are in the CLC or not. It doesn't matter if you go to church regularly or if you don't attend church. When it comes to sin, the statement is true about you. You have sinned and you have fallen short of God's good opinion. And yet here we're presented with another great nevertheless. As Paul tells us, all have sinned and all are justified. In other words, each one of us can say, I have sinned, and yet I have been declared innocent, just as if I'd never sinned. And this declaration comes through our Lord Jesus Christ. It has nothing to do with any of us. In Christ's blood, now God has decided that we are worthy of his praise. Now he has declared us not guilty, as if we'd never sinned. And here we come to our last churchy word, propitiation. Not only is that a word that's hard to say, it's also hard to remember what that means. I'd like a little interaction here. Show of hands, who knows what propitiation means? A couple of us, that's good. Yeah, propitiation is, it's hard to remember what it means. And I actually don't have any mnemonic device to help you remember that. I'm sorry. But it's an important word to understand because it points us directly to Christ, our Savior. So propitiation is the act that someone does when they're trying to take off or appease the wrath of someone on behalf of someone else. So I'll give you an example. Say you have a little child who's roughhousing and he accidentally breaks a vase or a window or a mirror or something like that. And his parents are extremely mad at him. Now, you might have, this doesn't happen all the time, but you might have an older sibling who has pity and compassion on the younger sibling. And out of love, he steps in and takes the blame off of his younger sibling. He says, no, you know, I'm really the one who broke the mirror. And then the parent's anger is not on the little child, but rather is diverted onto the older sibling. So this is a good example of what propitiation means. The older sibling is propitiating the parents. He's taking their wrath off of the younger sibling. So when we talk about propitiation in Scripture, we're focusing directly on Christ's act that he did on the cross and propitiating the Father, taking his anger off of each one of us. Now, a lot of churches these days, they try to take the focus off of the cross. They deem the cross as being dark and unloving, something we don't really want to talk about. And then they say things like, well, if we have a loving God, why would he let his son die? Or if we have a loving God, why wouldn't he just forgive us without a sacrifice? Now, the reason why churches do this, taking the focus off the cross, is because they also take the focus off of the law. If you don't hear the law, if you don't recognize and if you're not taught that you are sinful and that you're deserving of punishment, why would you need to hear or believe that you need a Savior? And that's why people take the focus off the cross. But this word propitiation that we're talking about, this focuses us directly on both those aspects, that we're sinful and we need a Savior, and Christ came and acted as that Savior for us. Now, the amazing thing when we're thinking about Christ's propitiation for us, the amazing thing about God's love for us is that in God's perfect, just nature, he declared and demanded that payment needed to be made because of our sins. But he also knew that because we're sinners, we wouldn't be able to make that payment. He knew that none of us had anything valuable enough to pay to appease his anger. And so not only did he declare and demand that we needed to make a payment, but he also provided the payment for us. He provided the payment in his own life as Christ died on the cross for us. So this is why we focus on Christ's death, because in Christ's death, we have been given life. So this last word, propitiation, is a very bittersweet word. It's bitter because in it we see that Christ had to go through a lot of suffering and pain and even died. It's bitter because we see that the reason he had to do this was because we are all sinful and because we couldn't pay the payment of our own sins. And yet it's also so sweet because we see that the reason why Christ was willing to divert God's wrath onto himself was because he loved us. And because we see that now that Jesus has done that for us, God isn't angry at us, but rather he sees us in love. He's declared us justified and righteous because of this. So now it's very sweet because we have been given forgiveness and life through Jesus. So, righteousness, justified, propitiation, all churchy words that people try to avoid, they get scared away from, words that we may at times forget the meaning of. But they are truly words to live by. Not words that we should do these things and then live to have a great life, but words by which, and through Christ's suffering and death, we have been given life. Words by which we truly, spiritually, are alive. They emphasize the life-giving work of our Savior who gave us his own righteousness so that we could be seen as right in God's eyes, so that he could declare us not guilty, justified, just as if we'd never sinned. And he did this by placing his own life in front of ours and by dying on the cross, propitiating the Father's wrath away from us, in order to bring us life instead. So may we continue to live rejoicing in these churchy words, because we know that in them Christ has promised us eternal life. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.
the depths I have cried to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you, Lord, should mark transgressions. O Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you. But there is forgiveness that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits. And in his word I do hope. My soul waits for the Lord. My soul waits more than those who watch for the morning. Yeah, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy, mercy, yeah. And with him is abundant redemption, yeah, redemption, yeah. He shall redeem me from all my offenses, all my offenses. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I do hope. My soul waits for the Lord, my soul waits who watch for the morning. Yeah, the morning will come. More than those who watch for the morning. I'll wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I do hope.
Sake of Elmer Goldowski, who is going through some health problems, we also pray for his health. Let's join in prayer. O God, the Father, you are the loving creator of all things in heaven and earth. You are over all, supreme and mighty in your sustaining power. We bow in prayer before you and offer to you our praise and prayers. Daily impart to us, for the sake of your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, pardon for all our sins and confidence in his redeeming grace. By your power, rescue us from every temptation of the devil, the world, and our own sinful flesh. Protect us from all danger to our souls. Since we are powerless, by our own reason or strength, to live worthy of our calling in Christ, pour out upon us your Holy Spirit, that we may grow in those virtues which are pleasing in your sight. Instead of our stubbornness and self-will, give us submission to your will. Instead of our pride and conceit, give us lowliness of mind and a willingness to serve. Instead of our grumbling and complaining, give us a spirit of gratitude and contentment. Instead of our resentment and anger, give us patience. Help us, by your grace, to bear with each other's faults and weaknesses, to serve one another in love and kindness, and to bless those who may seek to harm us. Look in mercy on your church, O God, and grant that we may keep in peace and love the unity which you give. Give to us an abiding sense of our oneness and faith in Christ, in repentance for sin, in knowledge of Bible teaching, and in obedience to all of your revealed will. Bless our nation, that throughout our land people may worship and serve you in spirit and truth. Be the guardian of all our families, dear Lord. Enable all parents to give their children a godly example, loving discipline, and wise spiritual counsel. May the word we use in our homes be such that build up each family member in faith and trust toward you. Lord, we'd also like to pray this morning on behalf of Don and Bev Gescheidel. We'd like to offer a prayer of thanksgiving for blessing them with 59 years of marriage and for blessing them with many of the blessings that come along with marriage, with children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Most of all, Lord, thank you for keeping them together faithful to you, and grant, Lord, that they may remain faithful through the rest of their lives. We'd also like to pray on behalf of Elmer Goldofsky, who's having some health problems, as you know. Lord, please bless him in his health. Reassure him that you are the great physician who is in control of all of our well-being. And Lord, please grant him the assurance of his salvation in you. Oh God, work your healing power for the blessing of all those who are sick and afflicted. Hear their cry and remember them in your mercy, lifting them up by the power of your Spirit. Show yourself to them as a very present help in trouble. Increase their trust in you through the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we also stand and join to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. The children will sing our closing hymn of the day. The rest of us may be seated. Thank you. Well, good morning again. The announcements are as follows from our bulletin. Forgot to highlight anything. On Tuesday, is that this Tuesday? Yeah, this Tuesday we're having our school committee meeting at 6:15, and the elders will be meeting at 6:45. Looking ahead, in 2 weeks, October 4th, I'll be coming back with my fiance Jess for the Mission Festival. Jess will be presenting on Bible class on her trip to Africa this past summer, her mission trip, and I'll be preaching the worship service, so I hope to see you all there. Outside of that, I don't think there are many announcements. I'd just like to thank everyone for the summer. It's been a really, really awesome experience for me, and you know, 4 months here have been growing a lot, and I just can't be thankful enough. You know, my sermon I talked about bittersweet, and today is very bittersweet for me. Sorry. You know, I'm sad to be leaving. I'm sad to not be able to see you guys every week. I'm extremely happy to go home and see my family again and my friends. And even more sweet than that, I think, is the relationships that I've built with all of you here. And knowing that we all share a common faith in Jesus Christ, our Savior. And that is the sweetest thing of all. So thank you again for all your support this summer. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your support. Thank you for cards and encouragement and everything you've done for me. The Lord's blessed me richly. Thank you.
You did what I was hoping you would do. Thank you, Sam, very much. So, we'll see you again. We'll continue to invite you here to guest preach while you're going through the rest of your seminary. And thank you for all you've done for us. We really appreciate it. Lord, be with you.
Deep but short.